charts. I provided several charts for you guys to look over, and those charts are talking about the pure memory. Remember, number one thing to keep in mind is that this test itself, the CBLE, is really a test which looks at your time management skills, and the goal is to be able to do one question at about 3 minutes per each. That implies that on some questions you'll be, and this is on average, so that implies that you'll be spending on some questions less, on some questions more. So the chart that I suggested also invites you to strategy, to put a strategy together before you put before you start answering questions on the exam. And this means that you have to determine which questions take you less time, which questions take you more time. And on general, what I've shown here is the chart that is based on my experience allows folks to manage their time if first and foremost they focused on CFR. So we're talking about the non-valuation, non-FTA CFR, so just pure CFR without any combos. There is a valuation portion of CFR, and this is the one that will take more time than other stuff, so I would leave it for last. The next one is classification and classification free trade agreement combos. So the suggestion is to focus on non-valuation, non-free trade agreement, code of edge regulations, for example, what type of form you must use for this and this and this, or what must you use for that, that and that. So in other words, it's very important for you guys to develop a plan which questions you're going to tackle first, which questions you're going to tackle last. And that means also that based on this stuff that you are doing, you will also need to understand that when you sit down and that very first page, the very first screen that you will be seeing when your exam starts, and this is the reason why it's very important to go to that Pearson website and do review the stuff that they provide so that you feel comfortable, you will be able to jump back and forth from question 59 to question 26, from question 9 to question 55, for example. So this is something that you will have to have before you, the day you come to the exam, and though this chart was designed to help you with just that. After covering the basics, I think it's a good time now to dive into the, we're going to talk about the question of efficiency, and I think it's a good time to dive into the another time saving strategy which we should develop as we try to successfully pass a customs broker license exam. And so we talked about structuring your questions, going to the Code of Federal Regulation, just pure CFR first. But once we get to the question itself, at the question level, we also should have a strategy which we need to follow, because if we will be all over the chart, if you will, if we will not have a critical approach of solving questions on the customs license broker exam, you will lose a lot of time. I'm not saying that you will get those questions wrong, right? But during the customs license broker exam, and some of you may have seen it when you took a look at the past exams, and you found that there was customs broker license examiners, they threw at you a bunch of information which is not really relevant to the question. And the goal is to drag this time out so that way you have less time to solve. So critical reading of the question, I think, is very important. And this is, so let's talk about it. Let's dive in into the outline that I sent you guys out earlier, because we need to build out the build our foundation. Before I dive into the outline, I had some questions about the textbook. So the textbook itself, like I mentioned before, is a roadmap. And that roadmap, when it was designed, it starts out with just basic building blocks, eligible, not eligible, and then it goes in to the general provisions, which we're about to jump into. And general provisions does set out the general platform from which we can go in and out and have the ability to dive into the HTS, to dive into the various provisions of Code of Federal Regulations, because it acts as kind of like a binding circle, which kind of like makes it easier for us to be able to get to other provisions. Going back to that so-called roadmap of the textbook, the rest of it was designed with the mind of the supply of the supply chain. So recall that my little speech about that book and the complexity of the supply chain. If you are in a world of customs business, you have to keep in mind that there is a starting point processes, and then you have other processes that follow, and they start all the way back at the origin. So at the origin, you, for example, at the origin, you have to know the introduction from yesterday, right? And the general provisions of today, they will provide the general tone. But then, for example, the international commercial terms are necessary for you guys to know, because they, well, number one, some of them have been codified and became part of the Code of Federal Regulations. Others are just being thrown at you at the exam without ever being codified. So when you look at the invoice, and the commercial invoice is created before the importation takes place, you do have terms and provisions listed there, and this is done before the actual merchandise leaves its country of export toward the United States. So that's one link. Another link is classification. Of course, classification is a huge part of the exam. We'll be spending lots of time on classification, but also the HTS number is a driver for determination of the duty. It can be a driver for determination of the country of origin. It can be a driver for determination of whether you have other regulatory enforcement actions, let's say anti-dumping, let's say you have now exclusions, you have Section 301 tariffs, for example, whether you have other barriers, whether you have some marking requirements, all of which have to be decided prior to the merchandise actually hits the border. So logically speaking, those stuff that we're going to cover, they take place at the beginning, from the time. So let's say this is China, let's say. So, and it goes to the United States. Okay, so before it actually leaves, you do have to know the terms, such as Incoterms. You do have to know the HTS to find out if the merchandise can be entered and what is the price and what are the regulatory requirements. Next, so that's classification. And then you have to, once the merchandise, before the merchandise leaves the country, you have ISF, right? Importer security filing, if it's ocean. So it's, some of you may know it, this is 10 plus 2. Whatever it is, this stuff is still in the books and it's been tested. So logically, this is the next step to go about. Then the merchandise arrives at the border. What are your questions? Well, am I gonna rail it, or am I gonna track it to, let's say, from Los Angeles, from one destination, let's say LA, to Minneapolis, and then clear this merchandise in Minneapolis? That's relevant. What about the bond? If it's a formal entry, meaning the entry, let's say, over $2,500, it should be a formal entry, so it requires a bond. We'll be talking about that. So as we move farther out, we're dealing with questions of rail arrivals, we deal with the questions of bond, and as we progress farther down, at the time we are making the entry, who has a right to make one? Powers of attorney, we discussed this a little bit. This is all done as the merchandise moves through its process toward its final destination. And then we hit the actual entry stuff, payment of duties and taxes and fees, and all this other stuff associated with it. That have been tested on the customs license broker exam. Free trade agreements. And then as we move beyond the entry, we have we have a lot of sidelines, right? So we can have informal entry versus formal entry. As we go farther down, we do get to the liquidation. We do get to the post-entry procedures, such as administrative review, drawback. I put customs broker responsibilities towards the end, not because it's not relevant or important, but because this is something I used to cover customs broker responsibilities as the first thing, but I kind of decided to do it later towards the background, because towards the back or latter part of the class, simply because once we get the procedure down, we are able to focus on so-called ethical requirements, and customs broker responsibilities has to do with a lot of ethical requirements and procedural requirements on making sure how to run the business. So, and then we jump back to the entry and stuff that can go wrong, such as fines, penalties, forfeitures, IPR problems, detentions, protests, and other administrative procedures that are out there. So this is a roadmap that is designed And the goal is here to move from the early stages of of importation to the United States, and address all the issues that have been tested on the customs broker exam as we move to the final closure of the customs broker license examination. So that's the roadmap for the class.